includes various classifications and various diseases. Today we will be talking on mainly on the haemolytic anemias. I will not be discussing detail on each of the causes for haemolytic anemia. I will give the overview regarding how we approach and what are the common causes and what are the clinical pictures seen in haemolytic anemia. Rest of the some of the disorders you might have already have been taught in other pediatrics as well, regarding that thalassemias and sickle cell anemias, and that is similar in medicine as well. So regarding those individual disorders, you can go through the books. I don't think that has to be taught individually for now, but in this lecture class I will give the overall overview of the haemolytic anemias, what are the different causes, what is the mechanism behind that, and how do we classify and approach a patient with haemolytic anemia. So I'll be discussing on that, and mainly on the autoimmune haemolytic anemias. Rest of the disorders you can go through the books. Especially the importance are the sickle cell and the thalassemias, also hereditary spherocytosis, that also is a common disorder. So whenever we classify anemia, basically you might have been taught regarding the classification according to the size of the RBC, regarding normocytic, whether it is normocytic or microcytic or macrocytic. But the overall conceptual classification is basically three. We divide into three groups. One is the either there is decreased production of red blood cell, or either there is increased destruction of those normally produced red blood cell, or either there is acute blood loss. So main these three group of classification we discuss during the overall classification, and today we'll be discussing on the increased destruction of the red blood cells in the haemolytic anemia. So regarding the definition, it is the anemia due to shortened survival of the circulatory RBC because of their premature destruction in the peripheral circulations, or either in the reticular endothelial system or in the intravascular. So there are numerous causes of haemolytic anemia. Haemolytic anemia as a group constitutes of many disorders, and this can broadly be classified whether they are the inherited or the acquired causes, or regarding whether the presentation is acute or chronic, or it is mild to very life-threatening severity. According to that, we classify this group of disorders. So basically they present with anemia. So we'll be today discussing on haemolytic anemia. So basically the presentation varies among different patients. So whether there is acute decrease in the hemoglobin level or the disorder is chronic, and sometimes these haemolytic anemia could be a medical emergency, especially in cases of haemolytic anemia where you need to have other modes of treatment, especially use of plasmapheresis or transfusion, or even the use of corticosteroids in those conditions. There are general common features among these patients in cases of haemolytic anemia. The patient usually have some common features between them, and the most noted is the presence of pallor and associated jaundice, because you might be knowing the metabolism of bilirubin, where does it come from, the after the degradation of hemoglobin to M and globin and the cycle. Because of that increased RBC destruction, there is invariably presence of jaundice. When the system is oversaturated, then there will be presence of unconsecrated bilirubinemia in those patients. So it indicates signs of hemolysis. And the other features is the splenomegaly, mainly in the inherited causes you find splenomegaly. And similarly, the other features of hemolysis is the increase in the reticulocytes count. Because of that, we differentiate whether there is overproduction from the bone marrow, or the bone marrow is responsive to the hemolysis or not. Especially in case of hemolytic condition, there will be increase in the premature RBCs. Reticulocytes are the premature RBCs. So the bone marrow tries to compensate by production of reticulocytes. So there will be increase in reticulocytes. As I have mentioned, bilirubin, there will be unconjugated bilirubin will be high. Similarly, other signs of hemolysis, such as increase in the LDLs. LDLs is also one of the enzymes that is present in the cellular level. No? So when there is increased destruction, then the LDLs level will rise. Similarly, haptoglobin is the one of the protein produced by the liver, which binds with the hemoglobin. And because of the increased hemolysis, the binding increases with haptoglobin, and there will be reduced level of haptoglobin, which is also sign of one of the sign of hemolysis. So all of those hemolytic anemias have these features in common. Whenever you suspect a patient with anemia, there is jaundice and associated other increased reticulocyte count or increased LDLs, unconjugated bilirubinemia. So all these features indicate there is increase in the RBC destruction in the body. So as I mentioned, hemolytic anemia can be categorized according to different classification, according whether the abnormalities is within the intrinsic, within the RBC, or it is extrinsic to the RBC, classified as intracorpuscular or the extracorpuscular defects. Similarly, many of these disorders could be inherited, they could be acquired, could be acute, chronic, and there are various classifications, could be immune-mediated and non-immune-mediated, and many of these can be classified according to the site of RBC lysis, RBC damage, could be intravascular within the vessels, or it could be extravascular hemolysis, mainly in the liver, spleen, or other glands, lymph nodes. So most of the inherited disorders that we are talking regarding the hereditary spherocytosis or G6PD deficiencies, pyruvate kinase deficiencies, all these are the mostly the intracorpuscular defect. Many of them are inherited, and most of these regarding the other causes, mainly the immune mediated are extravascular. We'll talk that in detail of it. So many of the one of the classification, one of the very common is the whether the defect is the intracorpuscular or the extracorpuscular. In cases of intracorpuscular, you might know the structure of hemoglobin. Hemoglobin with alpha chain and non-alpha, beta or gamma chains are there. Similarly, it has its own membrane. If there is defect in any of these, structure of hemoglobin or the defect in the membrane, you might be learning that in pathology about the enkinin and spectrin proteins that maintain the normal structure of the RBC. So any of those defect on that or the enzymatic level in cases of G6PD or pyruvate kinase, then it leads to the intracorpuscular defect, leading to premature rupture of those RBCs. So these are all the intracorpuscular. Similarly, the extracorpuscular are outside of that of the RBC. They include the premature loss of the membrane, like cytokine-mediated or immune-mediated loss of those cell structures, or there is change in the solubility of the hemoglobin due to different toxins or the because of the oxidative damage to these cellular structures and proteins, it causes the premature lysis of those RBCs. So these are all incorporated under the extracorpuscular defect. Similarly, this mechanism could be mechanical, could be related to mechanical injury, or could be immunological, infectious, or other oxidative damage. And as I've told, extracorpuscular defect could be immune-mediated, antibodies-mediated, especially in the cases of hemolytic anemias, transfusion-related reactions. It could be autoimmune and or drug-induced. In those cases, the antibodies against those attack the RBC membrane component. Similarly, it could be because of enlarged spleen. As you might know, the RBCs, they enter through the spleen, and they get trapped in the spleen, and because of the monocyte and macrophages, it takes off the hemoglobin and leads to the processing. So whenever there is hypersplenism, all those sequestration of RBC can occur in the spleen, large spleen, leading to the stasis and destruction of the RBC. Similarly, mechanical trauma, the example includes the mechanical valves. In case of rheumatic heart disease, when it says like the replacement of those valves, because of those high jet velocity across those valves, there will be lysis of those RBC. This is a cause of mechanical trauma. Similarly, in cases of DIC and TTP also, there are condition will there leads to the rupture of this RBC. Similarly, these other could be, as I've told about the oxidant potential, especially in the G6PD patients, whenever you give various drugs, sulfonamides or anti-malarials or other NSAIDs, then it leads to the premature destruction of those. Similarly, other infectious cause are there, and other toxins related, especially in the snake and insect bites, this condition occur. So this is one of the like classification, as I've told, intracorpuscular and the extracorpuscular. In the intra, it is mainly of hereditary causes, and in the extra, it is mainly due to the acquired causes. As I mentioned about the different acquired causes leading to the extracorpuscular. So one of the classification is in this category. Similarly, these are the inherited. As I've told, inherited are mostly the inherited related to the RBC, intracorpuscular defect. These are related to either the cell membrane or the enzyme or the hemoglobin itself. So in the hemoglobin itself, most common is the thalassemia and the sickle cell. In the enzymes, main one is the G6PD and other is the pyruvate kinase. And in cases of membrane, it is hereditary spherocytosis and cryptocytosis. So these are the classifications. Similarly, most of the acquired can be divided into immune-mediated and non-immune-mediated. In immune-mediated also, the antibodies are classified as warm and cold antibodies according to the varieties of the antibodies that it like saturates blood. Similarly, the other non-immune causes are mainly the causes, as I mentioned previously, extracorpuscular causes. So there are various classification. Similarly, one is the immune versus the non-immune. Immune hemolysis refers to the RBC destruction by the antibodies and the complement in the body. Similarly, immune is classified with non-immune according to the Coombs test. Coombs is the direct antiglobulin test. It detects the antibodies present in the RBC membrane itself. That is the direct Coombs test, and the other is the indirect Coombs test. Indirect Coombs test detects the antibodies present in the plasma of the patient. So these are the two tests. So especially when there is direct Coombs test positive, we label it as an immune-mediated hemolytic anemia. And similarly, immune-mediated hemolysis could be either autoimmune related or it could be like transfusion related. And also drugs are the other causes in the immune-mediated diseases. Similarly, regarding the autoimmune hemolytic anemia, as I mentioned about the similarly, these immune-mediated are further classified as the warm antibodies and the cold antibodies. Warm antibodies, mainly the IgG, are involved, and they bind best in the warm temperature, that is at around 37 degrees centigrade. So they are regarded as warm antibodies related diseases. And other is the cold. The binding occurs mainly in the lower temperature at 4 degrees centigrade. So these are labeled as the cold antibodies related disease. So in these cases, IgM antibodies is the main culprit in the cold antibodies. So regarding the direct and the indirect Coombs test, present in the autoimmune hemolytic anemia. In direct Coombs test, these are the antibodies that is like we test in the Coombs reagent. So whenever they are mixed with the patient's serum, in the patient serums, the antibodies against the RBC membranes are already present in the patient's RBC. So whenever you give the antibodies to those present in the RBC membrane, you give antibodies against those human immunoglobulins. So there will be precipitation of those blood. So this is the positive direct Coombs test. It signifies mainly the presence of antibodies in the RBC membrane itself. So these are useful in cases of autoimmune hemolytic anemia, hemolytic disease of the newborn, and the especially in the transfusion reaction. And in the indirect Coombs test, the patient's plasma already contains some antibodies, and you you mix with the RBCs containing antigen against those antibodies. So there will be mixing of those antibodies to that known red blood cell antigen. And whenever you give the other antibodies against those antibodies to those immunoglobulins, mainly the IgG and IgM, then there will be a reaction. So this is the indirect Coombs test. So indirect Coombs test, in a sense, it detects the antibodies in the serum, mainly in cases of post-transfusional reactions, in the pre-transfusion, when you look at, we usually check for direct to look for the any antibodies against the RBC is present in the blood or not. That is important in the pre-transfusion testing, and also in cases of in pregnancy to know the whether the newborn will have any hemolytic anemia with the presence of those plasma antibodies. So indirect Coombs test is for detection of those already present antibodies, whereas in the direct test, it usually signifies the antibodies that are present against the directed RBC cells. So this one is important, you go through again and again so that you can know that. Because there are two different mechanisms for direct and indirect test. And whenever you label an autoimmune hemolytic, there will be already present of those antibodies, and you mix with the reagent against those antibodies and look for the precipitation, okay? Agglutination. So this is the direct test. So these are the autoimmune hemolytic anemias, right? These are the features of autoimmune hemolytic anemias, warm and cold antibodies. And whenever you detect, the management is little different than other type of hemolytic anemia.